بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الصلاة والسلام على رسول الكريم وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. ما بعد. We're now in part two. There were people who had they have a question, I have a comment, and Imam Nathari was saying that he had some other stuff he wanted to cover, but we didn't have time to cover. How many of you were here in the first part? Raise your hand. All right. So that means there's so many people here in the first part. You can't recap the first part. So you got to pick up from where you want to pick up from.
But we only have until 45 minutes, then we have to wrap up.
Bismillah, salatu wassalam. And Sayyidina wa Habibina Muhammad ibn Abdullah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam taslim al kathira amma ba'd. Brothers, no sisters came back yet, so assalamu alaikum. Yeah. Before we pick up, I want to mention something because you mentioned something about, on the Musalla, about the work that we're trying to do, engaging the nation. And certainly would be remiss if we didn't mention our brother, Imam Siraj, who you know has always been engaged in the forefront, in spite of all critics and detractors about him engaging, engaging the nation of Islam. What I want to say, everyone in here, I assume, is familiar with the hadith of Mu'ad that we often use for dawah, and I'll give it some context in English for the sake of time. This is the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he was addressing Mu'ad, and one of the things he began to instruct him before he left, he said, "You're going to a people who are from among the people of the book. So let the first thing you call them to be that they should make all worship for Allah only." He said, "Then if they accept that, then you should tell them that Allah enjoins upon them five prayers in the day and the night. And if they accept that," and then he went on, and then he stopped at charity. He said, "And if they accept that, then accept from them the charity, but don't take the best part of the people's property," meaning those things that, didn't belong, to the Muslims. Don't just go and you're not gonna rob nobody under the premise of collecting charity. And I say that to say, I reference that hadith to say that any time you're giving dawah in America, and sometimes for the sake of people understanding what we're doing, Imam, I've been using the term more and more for the past 10 years, maybe now, civic engagement. That's our dawah. Our dawah is civic engagement. Not just what we say, but how we live, how we interact among the people is the best form of dawah that we can ever think about giving. And when you're giving dawah to an organization, an entity like the Nation of Islam, it has to be a very, as we would call it in a linguistic sense, it has to be a very nuanced conversation. Because they have a particular way that they think, they have a particular way that they've been, regimented, and it's beneficial for you to understand who you're talking to, when you're talking to them. And that would be the same for all of us, Anytime we're in a situation where Allah has put us in a position where we can, invite people to Islam and share with them about, Allah and His Messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam, we need to have some familiarity and some context about the people we're talking about. So this way you try to appeal to them through things that strike at their sensitivities and that will appeal to basically, the core where they are from. So in the engagement work that we do with the nation, obviously the biggest benefit that I have is that what? That was me, that was my family. So there's no better level of familiarity because I can make the arguments that they would make better than they do. Because I was taught that from a child. It was ingrained in my thought process. So if I'm not in debating with them, but if I'm gauging them around something, I know how they're going to answer before they answer. But I'll tell you this, it's a very specific conversation, and I would venture to say, and Allah knows best, this is no disrespect to any of us, but the average one of us that would call ourselves a Sunni Muslim, you couldn't debate with them. Because they're sharper on what it is they know than the average Muslim maybe sometimes is sharper on what we say we on, as we used to say in our Salafi days, and on our minhaj, what you on. They on what they on better than what we on, better than we are on what we on. So right now, Allah has put us in a very unique position, in a very strategic position, and I'm grateful to be in that position. And one of the things that I found, you know, in just my interaction and engagement of the nation is that even many of the books that are written in the English language or that are translated, they're not books that are particularly good for, you know, people that, you know, we're inviting to Islam, particularly from within the context of the nation. Ultimately, we accept the good of these authors that wrote a lot of these books, may Allah reward their intent. But certainly we know that a lot of the information that's been translated is usually not translated oftentimes by English speaking people, you know. I'm gonna give you one of the far glaring examples. Some years ago, somebody gave me this book, and it was describing how the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, how he prayed, as if the Prophet only prayed one way. We had that discussion another day. As if you can quantify that of all the years that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was among the Muslims, that's the only thing he did. He never did anything outside of what they put in that book. All right. So anyway, one of the translations of this particular book, they was talking about making the takbir. And in the language of the book, it said that the Messenger of Allah, I'm quoting now, the Messenger of Allah, peace and blessings be upon him, would make takbir, and he would raise his arm so high where you could see the whiteness of his armpits. It might not seem like a big deal to you, but when we're dealing with a people who are constantly fighting the yoke of white supremacy, and when you're dealing with a people who still, even after being freed, are still dealing with people that are trying to gain favor of their former slave master and their children, this is really an offensive statement. Because those of us that know even a little capful of Arabic, that we know Imam Jahari, we know that we could think of 20 other words that we could use other than the whiteness of the Prophet's armpits. So you find these kind of things, and there's less glaring examples that we can mention, but a lot of this stuff just isn't written with the English speaker in mind, and we have to be real specific in terms of books that we're giving folks, because one of the biggest fears that goes on within nation circles is that they're gonna become, as they would call it, Arabized. So now, a person who, again, is productive, within the context of the nation, now he's doing his best to strive to become, a Muslim, in totality, adhering to all the norms and all the things that we know to be part of the Quran and the prophetic tradition. But now somebody's made him think that, he has to dress a certain way, or he has to eat a certain kind of food, and he has to talk with this accent, brother, yes, alhamdulillah. People would actually make you think that. We were in a nation mosque in Baltimore before Juma, and one of the brothers from the nation came in, and he had, nice little kufi on. So he started talking to Carlos, I told him Mr. Carlos Muhammad. He starts asking him, he started basically, as we would call it in the nation, he starts sciencing up around the religious significance of a kufi. Oh yeah, man, brother told me, I wear this kufi, man. I get more blessings. So Carlos let him down easily. He didn't just crush him. But after he finished, I said, may I? And I just gave him the reality. I said, that kufi has nothing to do with Islam. Nothing to do with Islam. Right? Don't make your prayer no more valid. Don't make your prayer no more authentic. And it certainly don't make you a more authentic Muslim because you're wearing a kufi. But some people, if they're given Islam within that context, they would start to think that certain things that they read in certain literature, that it's a religious norm, when in many cases, it might just be a practice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he did out of personal preference. It may not have one iota to do with anything in terms of the Sunnah, the prophetic tradition, among those things that we know, as Allah says, that he doesn't speak, of his own opinion. He only speaks, through revelation, which he's inspired by. So when we're having these conversations and we're engaging the folks in the Nation of Islam, it's something that we take very serious. And when I'm having these conversations with brothers, because I'm always usually having offline conversations, And it's usually one of two varieties where brothers are encouraging me, you know, the Imam Jaharis and others, keep doing the work that's important. And it's other people that they'll listen to everything he said, that Minister Farrakhan or somebody would say, and they immediately call me like I'm supposed to be the translator for everything that he says. It's like this show I used to watch on Comedy Central sometime, Key and Peele. They had a guy, he said he was Obama's anger translator. So President Obama would say stuff in a calm way, and this guy would come on and give the angry black man version of it. So you got some brothers that they listen to everything Farrakhan said. They call me, oh man, what's your man Louis talking about? I said, I don't know, I don't speak for Minister Farrakhan. Like, what did he say? So I say that to say that even when you're just trying to do good and, you know, be available, you know, as a resource, you know, nobody's trying to lead or take over the nation. We just want to be responsible in a way that Allah has made us to be responsible, you know, for our people. So when, you know, I hear from brothers and they're always having some critique, you know, I gave the khutbah of Master Taqwa for Eid al-Adha, perfect example. So a couple of the brothers I know are there from the nation, from Mosque number 7. In fact, the brother who's the director of protocol, when you go to visit there, he handles all the logistical stuff. He's there, so I notice him from where I'm giving the khutbah. Imam Siraj is on high, so he asked me, you know, would I come give the khutbah? Fine, alhamdulillah, we're there. So we give the khutbah. So I see the brother from the nation as I'm talking. I said, yeah, you know, and I want to welcome our brothers, you know, from the Nation of Islam that are here. And I said, and I see some people looking at me. Yeah, I said it, my brothers in the Nation of Islam. So as soon as I get outside, man, I might have spoke for only a half hour, made a lot of points about Allah and His messengers, spoke about things from the sources. The only point that the brother could call me on outside is, why did I call about the guys in the nation, my brothers? So now he gets me outside and he goes through the process that one of my friends in Philly talks about. He goes through the process, now he wants to haram me up. You know, he wants to get me outside and he wants to tell me about, yo, brother, you know, you can't call him your brother if they don't have, you know, the correct aqidah, blah, blah, blah. I say, well, you know, we are engaging them. So, you know, is it a sin before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that I refer to them even as my brother in humanity? I mean, as a human being, can I just refer to them? You know, can we engage them and give them dawah, you know, in kindness, you know, with a good spirit, you know, in a way, and argue with them, debate with them, what? In a way that's better. Exactly. So I get a lot of that. I do, you know. And so what I begun to start asking brothers now, I don't know, anybody here ever been in the military? Anybody ever been in the military? So they have this thing in the military called general orders. And we had an adaptation of that in the Nation of Islam that we used to use. The men were instructed in general orders, and they were the same general orders that's used by the armed forces, except it's just substituted wording. Instead of the army, it would say the mosque or the temple. So one of the general orders, and I still remember them from my developmental years as a child, was general order number 9, which states to allow no one to commit a nuisance on or near your post. So when I'm talking to brothers and they start critiquing me, I say, you know what, I understand. I understand if you don't want to support me. I understand if you think I'm wasting my time. That's fine. Okay, alhamdulillah. All I ask you is one thing, man. I ask you, you remember your general orders? No. Well, just in the spirit of number 9, just don't be a nuisance on my post. I mean, don't be in my way. All right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has allowed there to be a people for every people. So if Allah has put it, you know, in me and on my heart that this is the group that I want to focus on in terms of, you know, engaging them, giving them dawah, and to just, you know, engage them, then I think that I should have the right to do that without any issue. And let me tell you why it's so important before we take any questions. One reason why it's so important to me, because I remember last year particularly, when I was spending a lot of time in one of the particular mosques, I developed a relationship with the brother who was the captain of the men of the Nation of Islam in this particular city. So he called me one day to ask me a question. I was just running random errands, going to the dry cleaners. He called me, said, Imam, so like, I got a question. You got a minute? I said, sure, brother, of course, no problem. So he asked me a question, basic fake question, something that any of us would know that have been Muslim for any given time. So I answered the question for him and explained it to him. And he said to me, you know, Imam, thank you, brother, you know, praise be to Allah. And he said, you know, brother, that's why we love you. He said, because we used to ask these questions to the brothers and I'm not going to mention who he named, what community he named. He said, we used to ask these questions to the brothers, and the first thing they would say is, oh, what, you don't know that? So how is it that we have people that will come to you to ask you a question and want you to clarify something for them, and your response is going to be to ridicule them? Don't you do, what, y'all don't know that? If he knew, he wouldn't be asking. So this is the approach that I take, and now I'm at the point where I'm really just taking a proactive approach, because I've been around them enough that I kind of have a sense of the areas that they really, you know, need more support and development in, and that's the areas that I'm looking to focus on continuing to write. And with the encouragement of Tariq, Bilal, and Imam Johari, people like that, as Imam Johari always says, you know, we may not have the bandwidth, but that doesn't stop us from continuing to talk and continuing to do the work. And if we just are able to just affect a handful of people positively, then we're confident that Allah is going to continue to allow it to grow. And then the benefit is, you know, that we got 1, 2, 5, 10, however many people. That's people that know a little bit more about Islam incrementally that they didn't know before we engaged them. And that's and I maintain that that's how we have to be. And when we adopt that principle into the broader society in terms of people we're engaging, then we will see Islam that really take root, you know, in the way that it can take root. Because I would venture to say that many times people just accept Islam oftentimes by accident or by sheer happenstance. It's not usually through any active effort or engagement on our part. They just happen to be somewhere and hear something or have some exchange with some person, and Allah softens their heart to the message, and they'll just stumble in the masjid. It's very little to do with us in our engagement.
MEI. You said MEI, so you got to explain what MEI is. But this, one of the issues that I'm going to just take part of the prerogative of the chair. How many of you, by show of hands, like to make dawah? You like it. Right? How many of you think that you're reasonably effective in making dawah? Effective. Right? Reasonably effective. How can you tell if you're effective in your dawah? Huh? No, I'm asking a question now. How, we're going to get to your asking the question. Right now, I'm asking you a question. How do you know when you're effective in your dawah? So there is a kind of a feedback mechanism. You put something out. You see what the information that you get back. You then, well, he's been reading the Johari book of dawah. Except he said 4 or 5 types. I'm going to tell you the 5. These are the Johari 5. The Johari 5, right? Usually people think that the ultimate outcome of your dawah is the person says, La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. And some of those people are like the ones that Imam Nathari is talking about. That you talk to him, and it's like the Hamza effect. You know, Hamza coming off the desert and says, "What's the problem? Oh, your relative is Muslim. Really? Who? Muhammad? Yeah. Okay. So, and you roughing him up because of that? Yeah. So, well, guess what? I just joined his religion." What you got to say now? You know, he probably don't know nothing about it, except that if Amin Nathari is doing it, I'm doing it. There are a lot of rappers in America, they accepted Islam because another rapper accepted Islam. They said, well, if he's a Muslim, I'm a Muslim. So now teach me about what Islam is, right? We usually count that as like the pinnacle effect. The second outcome is the outcome that I call, and I'm stealing your time, amen. The second outcome is the outcome that I think of, like Abu Talib. What's the effect? What's Abu Talib's effect? He says he supports you in Islam. He understands what your message is. He'll defend you. Every consideration that you have, you think in your da'wah, you've been effective, but you feel bad because he didn't say La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. But he knows what Islam is and he defends Islam. He explains Islam to other people. We have people like that today. What's the woman? Karen Armstrong or John Esposito or other people. And when you listen to their speech, you say, anybody who listens to this who has half of a brain, they would accept Islam. Esposito says, but I just want to let you know I'm Catholic. Right? It's the Abu Talib. The third outcome I call the early Nagashi effect. Where the Nagashi in Ethiopia, after he understands what Islam is, he says the difference between what we believe in and what you believe in is no more than a line in the sand. So Islam, Christianity, Judaism, for them, alhamdulillah, it's a legitimate religion. Stop talking about the Muslims are bad. What they believe in is like what I believe in. Because you've made da'wah to them, they understand. That's a third outcome. And you can quantify it. You can ask them, where do they stand now? And they say, this is what I understand. The fourth outcome, what's the fourth outcome, you remember? Because you listed. Actually, a person who is probably, I might think of this as the Abu Sufyan effect. When the Quraysh are going to attack at the Battle of Badr, and they want to have this battle because they say the pretext is the caravan. Remember this? Abu Sufyan says, wait a minute. I did some intelligence. Our caravan is safe. Right? The Muslims, they're not interested in fighting us. I understand what they believe in and so on. They just want to be left alone. My advice as Abu Sufyan is leave them alone. I don't want to be Muslim. I don't particularly like Muslims. But I think you should leave them alone. Yeah, that might be. I think of Colin Powell when they were planning to go into Iraq. Colin Powell is on record to have said, what I understand about Islam and Muslims and this and that, it's a mistake. We shouldn't go in. It's going to be a battle that we won't be sorry that we ever got involved in. Just leave the Muslims alone. You remember that? The last one is a person. And some of them may come to Dar Hijra, they come and listen to a talk, they do whatever. And when they leave, they're convinced of one thing. They hate Islam. You say, how could they? They said, you know what? What they're talking about, if people accept that, no lottery. No alcohol. No pornography. I'm telling you, they're starting out, they're talking nice. But at the end of the day, if that idea catches on, we're all out of business, brother. Right? This is the Abu Lahab. Right? No matter what you say to him, he's not going to accept it. The reality is that out of these five, and he's hostile. He organizes people against it now that he knows how powerful your message is. Our objective is to take these four types minus the hater and to bring them together in order to transform society. And so that means there might be somebody in the Nation of Islam who you have a conversation with them. And I have met, by the way, in my da'wah, I've met many people. If you are open, if you're willing to be open, not to put people down, if you're willing to be that open conduit, If you say brother, sister, hola, ¿qué tal? ¿Cómo están ustedes? Right? Ni hao ma, genki desu ka? Right? People feel you're open. Then they say, you mind if I ask you a question? You're a Muslim. You say, yeah. They say, well, I was wondering, why do Muslims do this? Why do Muslims do that? All right? And you're open and informing and engaging. Subhanallah. The odds are they're going to become one of these four outcomes. They're going to say, La ilaha illallah. They're going to defend Muslims in their absence. They're going to say that there's no difference between us and them except something trivial. Or they'll say, I believe Muslims have the right to practice their religion here, even though I don't want to become one of them. These four outcomes are all positive for us. And believe me, they're the ones who will shut up the Abu Jahl and those people. At the end of the day, they have nowhere to go. And so my advice to you is when you're evaluating your da'wah, many people evaluate their da'wah by how many people take shahada. Many times, what Imam Nathari mentioned, many times, the person that you made your da'wah to, they were in Washington, D.C., they were in your taxi cab or in your business. 6 months, let me tell you a quick story, number two. There were some young people in Oklahoma City. Their school had visited a masjid for an open house event. You know, and they have baklava, and they have some posters and whatever, and they show a little video, and they talk about the Prince's five pillars and stuff like this, right? So I'm in Oklahoma City, and we're going into the IHOP after the program. And some young people are coming across the parking lot, and one of the kids says, hey, I remember one of the kids who was with me, right? He says, yeah, man. He says, I have been thinking about you ever since I came to the mosque. This is obvious. This is like months. This ain't like a few weeks ago. For months, that's something you said, it touched his heart. Something touched his heart from being in the masjid, learning about Islam. And so one of the brothers tapped me and said, Imam, come here, listen to this guy, right? He said, yeah, man, I've been really thinking about what you guys were talking about in the thing. So I said, what do you think? What were you thinking about? He said, I was thinking about Islam. I said, do you have any questions about Islam? He said, no. I said, so you want to become Muslim? He said, yeah. Like, wait a minute. Somebody, probably not just the guy he met at the masjid. He probably met Fulan and Fulan and Fulan and Fulan throughout his exchange. And all of those people probably thought, we haven't done anything. We gave him a book to read and to take home and whatever. The day you see a young man stand here and take shahada, it may have been your da'wah and your da'wah and your da'wah that you don't even know. They just looked at the guy with the hat on. See the guy right there? He had the hat on. And he did something, and I saw him do it. And he said, I can tell that guy's Muslim. And that's what I want to be. The transformative power of building that relationship. And sometimes when we are doing that da'wah, people criticize us. And then they say, well, what's your proof that these people are accepting Islam? He said, that's not my business. All of the Prophet's message was to convey. That's what they do. The people's decision whether they become Muslim or not, that's between them and Allah. So may Allah reward you, brother, for this work. He hosts classes. And this is deep for me. Can you imagine, I do this all the time, but I do this all the time with Christians and Jews. I was in a synagogue all morning this morning. who want me to come in. And one of the sessions I did was Islam 101 in a synagogue. Now you say, why would Jews and Christians want you to come in? But for somebody who's in the Nation of Islam to invite you to come in, they have to really trust you. And the work that Amin Nathari has done, they trust him. It would be helpful to us if we learned something about that work, so that when we meet those people, and by the way, people in the nation, men in the Nation of Islam are very obvious. They let you know they're in the Nation of Islam. If you recognize those signs and you recognize the techniques that Amin can share with us, you may be making a contribution. I remind people all the time, I wish I had a nickel in the Shahada of Malcolm X. Just a penny that I was somebody who said, La ilaha illallah, right? So that on the day of judgment, he could say, it was because I met Johari and he encouraged me and the deen, that's why I became Malcolm X. Al-Hajj Malik Shabazz. I'd be like, wow. So for us to know what it is, and these techniques, these sensitivities, the white armpit or whatever it is, to know how to make the dawah. I'm going to open it up, your question.
Assalamu alaikum. I would like to ask a question for the Imam. Do you give da'wah only Muslim nations? They call, do you give da'wah in anybody? Do you give da'wah a stranger? How you give and how you feel one day when you tell them about Islam?
Well, part of what I was saying is he specializes. He specializes in da'wah education to the Nation of Islam. So you talk about his specialty. I'll only say that da'wah, what I've learned is, by way of analogy, there's certain doctors, they specialize in heart disease or cancer, right, or orthopedic specialists. When you're making da'wah, if you're talking to Jehovah's Witness, they don't have the same aqidah as a Seventh-day Adventist. Seventh-day Adventists don't have the same aqidah as Catholic or the Baptist. You start talking to this Jehovah Witness, Jesus is not God. They say, okay. You're like, that was my big line. Right? They're like, no, that we don't have to, right? Yeah. So you have to make sure when you're making da'wah that you take the medical history of the person that you're trying to treat. You might want to see the signs and symptoms that they have. You might want to run some additional da'wah tests to find out what is it that they believe in and don't believe in. And then you start saying, I think I can diagnose what's their aqidah problem. And then you put forward a treatment program for that condition.
But yes, sir, to your question, no, we don't exclude anybody from our da'wah. But again, as Imam mentioned, we just have, sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts you in a strategic position. And when you're balancing resources and how you're spending your time, sometimes you have to make a decision to spend time in an area where you're most effective. So as Allah ta'ala would have it, that's the door that he opened. So I would be disobedient to Allah to not walk through that door and engage them, But certainly within our broader work, we engage, whoever Allah allows us to come in contact with. I put these pictures up for Instagram because I just wanted to show you something. That top picture, you're still on the screen here. That top picture, this picture is from a masjid that I serve as part of my rotation. I have a couple of masajids and centers that I have rotational commitments at. So this mosque happens to be the oldest mosque in the state of Delaware. Came from the Nation tradition. They established it in the 50s. It made the transition in 75. Now it's the largest masjid in Delaware, Masjid Al-Kawthar, Muslim Center of Wilmington. Every year, this school, St. Andrew's, which is one of the most prestigious private schools in America, every year they bring a class there on a school trip to get an introduction about Islam, and then they have to go back and they have to write about it. For the past 3 years, I've been on rotation at this masjid for 8 years now. For the past three, maybe 4 years, as Allah would have it, every time that they come is always when it's my Friday to give the khutbah. Because I always give the khutbah, unless I'm traveling out of the region, the fourth Friday in every month, I'm at this masjid. So what they do is we have a multi-purpose room in the back that some of the brothers, when we had the 20-year dinner that Imam Siraj spoke at. So they sit there, listen to the khutbah. Then after the khutbah and salat is over, they come into the musalla area where you see them, and we do a half hour, Islam 101. And you'd be surprised how much, you know, we've been able to get done just doing that engagement. And I know just from some of the responses that we get and some of the questions that they have, some of them may be going back to that school where they may be causing some issues, you know, because we're dealing with issues that are making them rethink certain things that are part of their fundamental upbringing, you know.
I used to teach a class at NOVA.
Introduction to Islam, right? Taught it for about 7 years. If you do this work long enough, you'll meet somebody, and a young Hispanic girl came to me in the masjid. She said, "Assalamu alaikum, ma'am." I said, "Wa alaikum salam." She said, "Good khutbah today." I said, "Oh, thank you." She said, "You don't remember me, do you?" I said, "You don't remember because I look different, because I'm wearing hijab. I took your class 10 years ago." Right? You don't, wallahi, these people, all these, the law of averages, you look at all them people in that thing, year after year after year, that they had a woman, her roommate in college was Chelsea Clinton. She's Muslim, Chelsea Clinton is Bill Clinton, right? And Hillary Clinton's daughter. You can't live with a Muslim all year long. You don't learn something about Islam, which then informs Hillary and Bill when they travel to Muslim countries, right? Their daughter's schooling them on the adab of this and that and how the Muslims do this and that, right? Wallahi, if when it gets that close, it's one of these four.
And to Imam Johari's point, this class, this school, every year it's a different class. It's never the same class. Never the same class. But it's always the same teacher and advisor. So every time they come, the students enjoyed you, and they're asking their questions and what have you. And the picture at the bottom is just a sampling of a gathering that we had at a nation mosque where we did a session during the month of Ramadan. To the far right is Imam Earl Alameen from Baltimore, one of the well-known imams in the community of Imam W.D. Muhammad. You know, so this is just a session that we did, and what we've begun formally doing. We've been doing the work, certainly informally, but finally, at the beginning of last Ramadan, I saw that there was starting to become such a need that we said, you know what, we need to institutionalize this thing. You know, and this is no, you know, may Allah bless all of the other efforts that are happening. You know, Al-Maghrib, there's a number of different ones we can mention. We felt that we needed to develop something specific to this group of people. To this group of people. And to supplement what we do in terms of the in-person classes, because I still maintain that online classes have some benefit. There's nothing like face-to-face engagement, man. You can do some supplementary stuff online by way of reinforcement, but the initial contact always has to be face-to-face because it's a different type of vibe, it's a different type of energy, it's just a different kind of interaction. But this particular place in Baltimore, I just have to note them as an example, because 1 year before the Nation of Islam, before Minister Farrakhan actually appointed Imam Sultan to be the imam, and they started to institutionalize Jummah throughout the country, Baltimore was already a year ahead of them with establishing Jummah. So you have different places that are evolving, you know, at a different rate. So our thing is to just be available for them to be consistent in doing the work. And again, as I mentioned earlier, the publication part it's very important because, you know, one thing about the you know, the organization that is the Nation of Islam, they're avid students, they're avid readers, they love information. And if you give them information, they will read. So it's just better for us to be able to inform and impact what they read than for them to be reading a lot of stuff that's only going to either further complicate, you know, what is easy. But we know as Muslims, that's one of the things that we've done, seems that in many cases, Imam, we've like mastered, you know, the art of making the simple things in Islam complicated. One of my friends, who used to be the Imam at the Germantown Masjid in Philadelphia, Yusuf, he used to come and do lectures. And he would start off lectures, he would always tell this joke. It was corny, but it made sense to people that was in the room. He used to tell this joke, he used to ask, you know, I'm gonna ask a question, how many Muslims does it take to put in a light bulb or to change a light bulb? So people would be like, oh, one person, two people. So Yusuf said three. He said three, so he explained. He said, one changes the bulb, the other holds the ladder, and the third one, he has to explain the fiqh of it all. And people used to laugh, but when you think about it, that really has become in too many instances the way of Islam, where for the person who's just coming into, you know, the space of Islam and being engaged by Muslims, we want to start them off with the most complicated things instead of just starting from the basics, you know, and, you know, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will allow them to grasp that, then we take them further and further, you know, in progression, as that hadith, you know, of Mu'adh that we mentioned earlier. So in short, you know, the Muslim Empowerment Institute is an initiative that began. We did a beta test of it in Ramadan 2015, very well received. And this year on January 1st, we formally kicked it off at the national level. And our motto for Muslim Empowerment Institute is, an educated Muslim is an empowered Muslim. Can't put it in any more simple than that. That's the power that a Muslim has, being educated. You can't defend yourself against shaitan. You can't engage in an intelligent conversation about Islam unless you're educated. So that's part of our, you know, our primary focus. And as Allah would have it, because of what Imam Johari alluded to earlier, because of the trust factor that's been established, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us where now we have unrestricted access to any nation mosque in the country. We want to go, we can show up, we let them know we come, and it's no problem. I don't have to go through no protocol. You know, it's the hierarchical organization. If you get approval from the minister that you can go, you can go. I got approval from the minister. If Amin Nathari wants to come teach a class, he's welcome. He can teach a class there. So what we're finding to be an effective strategy that we're going to use, Bilal, is that we're going to start going in the Nation of Islam. I don't know how many of you know about the Nation, but the organized group of men called the FOI, the Fruit of Islam. The men have separate classes, separate and apart from the women. What we're going to do, Bilal, is we're going to go start teaching basic Islam at FOI classes. So then the brothers can go back home and they teach their wives. See, because the sisters come out to these programs. They come and they sit through the weekend workshops and they're engaged. And many times, as the same thing happens even in the Sunni Muslim community, with all truthfulness, many of the women are more educated than the men in our community, Islamically speaking. They study, you know? Although they have, in many cases, less access to the masjid, you know, in a technical sense, many of them just study and are more diligent in their studies. So in the Nation, you have that same phenomena where they'll go to the classes and go to the workshops, and the men may not be there. So we're going to go to where the men are and start doing the sessions there. This way, they'll already have a foundation on which to build upon and continue to keep that work going. So, you know, inshallah, we're not going to belabor the point. I don't know if anybody has any more questions.
Bismillah, salatu wassalam ala Rasulillah. So actually, I'm sorry, actually, I just came late, but I think this is a very good topic that basically about da'wah and Muslims in general and the history of Muslims here in the United States. So my question actually starts from where you just finished, that basically we need to educate the Muslims basically to be able to engage in very in a conversation about Islam in a way that they can explain what the Islam all about. But we as people actually coming from outside of the United States, from different walk of lives, from different countries. We have our own packages, our own problems, our lack of understanding of the Islam itself. Also, I came here like 25 years ago. When I came, I found Muslims in a lot of Islam areas, especially in New York and some a lot of areas. The Muslims who are doing the opposite to what American people do. So a Muslim who sell alcohol, and who cheat and who lie, and they buy and sell food stamps, and they lie, they can do any mischief that you might think of. So, empowering Muslims, do we have to take in our considerations those Muslims who come from different, from Pakistan, from Sudan, from Saudi Arabia, from Egypt, from different, and every one of those have their own problems. In the United States also, African Americans, they have their own issue as well. So, is there any way that basically those, most of those communities, they come together, identify those issues, work on them? Because we as the Muslims, basically, we come to the masjid, and most of the time that's about it. So I don't really help in my community. I don't show that as the Muslims, when I do my work, it doesn't reflect my religion, because I don't act upon it. Because I know that Indonesia and some other areas, most of those will become Muslims not because of direct da'wah that has been given to them, but the behavior of Muslims that make them become Muslims. And they are more strong, they are strong Muslims than us, we born Muslim basically in Sudan or some other areas. So the question I wanna basically, is any effort that people, they sit down and have this kind of dialogue? Start from our masjid here. People, they come and pray for 20 some years. Nobody even recognize them, maybe sometimes. They're any of the unknowns. Even if they have problems, they might pass away somewhere. If they travel and pass away, that's it. Nobody even will hear or know where he is. How can we deal with these issues? Also, I work in a census bureau, basically. There's a lot of Muslims there. And I work in a lot of other areas, other companies. But I don't see the behavior of Muslims is any different than the majority of people. So how as the Muslims identify ourselves and tell people we are Muslims? And that's why we act this way. We go to the bathroom, we can clean the bathroom, because we're Muslims. So basically, so I would like just like to get your...
I'm gonna let you go first, but
I'm gonna keep a short answer, brother. Your point is very, you know, it's a very serious question, and that's part of what has to continue to happen now. And it happens in the conversations you're talking about. It happens in some places, but it doesn't happen on the level of with the consistency that it should happen. I'm going next weekend, by Allah's permission, I'm going to be in further in the heart of Virginia, a place called Martinsville, Virginia. And there's like three surrounding towns that have massages and centers. And I worked with the folks in Danville, where I was last year, to give a community-wide conference, Imam Jahari, really around the whole idea of functional unity. Different ethnicities, one of the massages and centers is African-American. You know, the Imam there used to live in Newark, New Jersey. It's James Shabazz Jr.'s Masjid Bilal. Yeah. His father was the Nation of Islam minister in Newark, where we grew up at. So anyway, they're bringing four massages together for a weekend program. They're gonna have Jumu'ah consolidated at, you know, at, you know, the biggest mosque. We're gonna do a Friday evening discussion and then a Saturday piece. So those conversations need to happen. But your other point is one that really resonates with me. That when you start talking about all these ethnicities, folks that come from other lands, you hit it right on the head. Everybody has their own problems. Everybody has their own problems. And this is why, again, when we're dealing and engaging each other, you know, within the work of Islam, we have to keep in mind that folks have these problems and have these challenges. Because sometimes we will just gloss over things and think that, you know, a person is Muslim, that all these other problems and issues that they have, they just go away. Or as we say in the African-American community, a person, you know, comes in, accepts Islam, takes Shahada, you know, and whatever was ailing him before then is just going to disappear because he says, La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. So he might have been a drunk, he may have used drugs, he may have had a gambling problem or whatever. So you bring him in, he takes Shahada, you give him a new Kufi, a Thawb, and a Quran. All you're going to have is a drunk gambler in a Kufi, Thawb, and a Quran. Until you get to the core of what it is that, you know, that those folks have to deal with. So those conversations have to happen on the ground in real time. And that gets back to the point that I mentioned earlier when I say that in many cases in America, it's different now than how it used to be. In the 80s, you would kind of see more, you know, folks would just come and attend the masjid or center that they, you know, happen to go to. Now you're starting to see places be developed along as what we would call ethnic lines, oftentimes specifically for those reasons that you mentioned. People have their own issues, and they want to deal with those issues from within the cultural context of how they know how to deal with those issues. So if I'm from Sudan, and I know that we have people that are immigrating here from Sudan, and they have certain issues, I don't want to go air that laundry in the masjid of other people. You know, I want to be able to have it kind of self-contained, you know, and be able to deal with those issues in-house. When I first started being involved in full-time dawah work, Imam Jahari, in 94, this is the year before we opened the masjid, 95% of my speaking engagements, you know what they were? They were from what we would call immigrant communities that used to invite me to give lectures for their youth on how to protect the youth from American culture and how to deal with the dunya. And every place I went, all throughout the East Coast, that was always the theme, because people started coming to this land, and even the people that had already been here, as they started to raise children, they started to see their children being impacted and drawn into this culture, where you wouldn't know the Muslim child if you walked into Tyson's Mall, whatever the mall is I went to before. You walk into Tyson's on a given day, you can't tell a Muslim child, the Muslim young person, from a regular young person in some cases. So all of the lectures begin to be based on those kind of things, you know, maintaining your Muslim identity as a youth and all those things like that. So that's the need for those conversations to happen. They have to happen where we are. And honestly, if we're at a masajid and center that we support, and we don't see that masajid or center engaging in that conversation, we need to speak with the responsible people and ask that it begins to happen. Because maybe I stand corrected. That's part of the engagement too, Imam Jai. Part of the intra-faith stuff that we have to deal with.
A couple of things are happening now at Dar Hijra. One, with the help of our new community liaison, is developing programs for in-reach, not just outreach, but in-reach, talking to one another to improve the quality of what we do inside the masjid. But I want to say something that really, I mean, I'm an American, I grew up in Brooklyn, but I've met over the years many Muslims who have internal flaws. But if their coworker says, Abdul, can you tell me something about Islam, right? Abdul said, Islam is this, 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 this. They said, but Abdul, you don't do that. He said, yeah, but you didn't ask me what I do. You asked me what Islam is, right? It's Ramadan. He says, yeah. They said, what's Ramadan? You don't eat from here to here, and you don't do this, you don't do that. They said, but Abdul, you was eating lunch with us, right? But wallahi, this is not, I grew up a Christian. I went to my church and I say, Pastor, are we supposed to do so-and-so, right? He said, no, you meet somebody else Christian, he tell you, well, I think it's okay to do a little bit of it, right? You don't have to be a fanatic. And so people were really impressed by Muslims. Even if they didn't do what Islam said, they at least said what Islam is. And that's the person is testifying against themselves. You and the person's, a lot of cab drivers do a lot of da'wah. Doing business, they're traders or whatever, and people ask them questions, they say, Muslim is supposed to do boom, 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 boom. And people are amazed that means that even though he's a liar, if I ask him about Islam, he won't lie. I mean, this is amazing to people in America. I know, there are no sisters here, I know Muslim men who sleep with women that they're not married to. They have Quran and they have other stuff, and the girl asks them, Muhammad, tell me about your religion. He said, my religion is boom, boom, boom. One morning he wakes up and the girl is gone. She left him a note and took the Quran. I want to be Muslim, but not with you. Wallahi, really, they said, because I meet the girl, I said, how did you learn about Islam? She said, my boyfriend taught me. What happened to him? Nah, I can't. If I'm going to be Muslim, I want the real. But this is amazing. He could have said, oh, in Islam, fornicating is okay, and this is okay, and that's okay. He starts testifying against himself, which is a profound testimony about the power of Muslims in the way that we take seriously, even if we're not practicing it, what the arkam of Islam is. So I just wanted, while we're beating up on ourselves, it's people like that that brought me to Islam, not him, but people brought me to Islam. These are some amazing, because they still have hope for Allah. Even though they don't do it, but they're not going to lie on Allah. It's a tremendous impact. I think that one of the issues that we talked about in terms of tonight, and Bilal, you raised it, I'm going to raise it again. We have to become closer as a community. If we're going to have the kind of impact, if you think about the companions of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and they were not perfect people. Tariq and I talk about that. We talk about some of these great Sahaba. They had problems. But they were excellent because they were transforming themselves. You know, like a guy who's a cripple who starts walking. I don't complain about how slow he goes. He used to not go at all. Right? Don't compare him to the guy who used to walk who's now running. They're not the same. People who used to bury their daughters alive, right? Leave that to start saying our daughters should inherit from our wealth. Whoa. That transition. Those people, they still had problems. They had issues. We have issues. But one of the things that makes them radically different from us, they were a community. They lived and died together. There is a famous narration at Hudaybiyah where they're trying to size up how much pressure can these 1,500 people that the Prophet ﷺ has brought to make Umrah. Their first assessment, they ain't gonna make it. They're gonna break under the pressure. They're all different ethnic groups. Some of them are ex-slaves, some of them are free, some of them women, youth, poor people. As soon as we put the hammer down on them, man, they're going to all break into their factions. Last emissary said, guess what? I visited the Emperor of Rome, the ruler in Persia and in Ethiopia. Never did I find any people who had more love and devotion to their leader than these people have to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I don't know if we have that. And when we get that, Bilal, then if I misbehave, some brothers, whatever their rank is, they can come to my house and say, Assalamu alaikum, Johari. I know I gotta let you in, right? You're gonna sit down and you're gonna say, we heard that there's a problem in your house. Now, if you need any help from us, let us know. But we're not going to allow you to continue to do whatever it is that you're doing because you're a Muslim. It's not acceptable. Wallahi, we're not at that place yet. If I go to some brother's house now and I start correcting him about the way he's not taking care of his family, he want to fight. And he can find other Muslims who will fight me. One day, just by example, Bilal, we couldn't do what y'all did back in the day. A brother called me. The husband is an African-American convert. The wife is from Senegal. He had a protection order against him. He's not supposed to go to the house. He showed up anyway. Came in the house. They had four or five children. He started acting up. And you know how the traditional way you have a big plate of food like this and all the children sitting around eating. Well, when the woman said, look, you're not supposed to be here. Why don't you leave? He went and he took the plate of food and he flipped it like this. All the food fell on all the children. He walked out. She said, Imam, what am I supposed to do? I said, let me handle it. So after Salat, I got about 15 brothers. And we went to his house. You can only do this if you have community. I said, now, all of these men who are with me, they will do what I ask them to do. And if I ask them to stop doing what they're doing, they will stop doing what they're doing. Yeah? This is important. Because the guy, he might say something, and one of the brothers feel offended, and if I say, brother, stop. We came to his house, knocked on the door. I said, Salaam alaikum. He looked outside, 15 brothers outside. I said, you're going to invite us in? We came in, we sat down, we had a conversation. I said, I brought all these brothers with me for only one reason. I don't want this to be a fight. Right? Nobody's going to be jumping up and we have to call the police or whatever, because I brought with me 15 brothers, all of them, you know all of them. The ones you know they know me. And we're telling you, the behavior that you had today is unacceptable. And if it happens again, I have instructed your wife to call the police and have you arrested. Because if you don't respect us and our authority, then we're going to turn you over to an authority that you will respect. Now, at a Dar al-Hijrah, it would be difficult for us to get to that place, but that's when you build the sense of community. It's not just we raise money if somebody dies and we don't have enough money to bury him. Everybody will bury him because this is the Fardul Kifaya. But if there's an issue at my house, you say, well, whose responsibility is that? That's Fardul Kifaya, brother. Right? So let's go to my house and make that happen. So the examples that we have from the Nation of Islam, in whatever little they knew about the Aqidah of Islam, they knew what the Maqasid of Islam was, what the objectives were. I want to thank Imam Amin Nathari for joining us.
It's 7:30. They're about to call the Iqama. I thank you for listening. All of this material will be available on the Dar Hijra YouTube channel. Bidhni Allah, I pray that if there was any benefit in this, the credit goes to Allah and His Messenger. And if whatever mistakes we made, we ask you to forgive us and not to make them again, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum.